We have very good grounds for accepting the biblical worldview that the universe was created out of nothing by God at some point in the finite past. I'll share a classic argument for creation and unfold some of the philosophical and scientific support for its premises.
Premise one, whatever begins to exist has a cause.
Things don't come into being from nothing. Two, the
universe began to exist, therefore the universe has a cause. And that would be an argument again for a transcendent creator of the universe.
And then you unpack what it is to be a cause of the universe in terms of timelessness, spacelessness, immateriality, and so forth. Now, in a deductive argument like that, if the premises are true, then the conclusion follows logically and inescapably, whether you like it or not.
Ooh, logically and inescapably. Well, that's fantastic, Bill. I wonder what else I can prove with this William Lane Craig-style philosophy. I know, how about logically and inescapably proving that Einstein was wrong about the speed of light? Premise one, an object that is pushed forwards moves faster than it was moving. Premise two, this can of Spam is an object. Therefore, it logically and inescapably follows that if this can of Spam is traveling at light speed and it's pushed forwards, it will move faster than the speed of light. And therefore, Einstein was wrong about things not being able to travel faster than the speed of light. And then you unpack what transwarp Spam speed must mean in terms of the only being that can move this transcendently fast must be the god Mercury, and that he must really like his Spam. Wow, did I just use a verbatim William Lane Craig style logic or philosophy or whatever he calls it to disprove one of the most robust and well-tested theories of all time. A theory of one of the greatest physicists ever. And it was so easy, so simple. Oh, go on, you tell him, Craig.
And it certainly seems to be more probably true than its negation. So when you put it in the form of a deductive argument like that, I think that it's a good argument for that conclusion.
This argument is so marvelously simple that it's easy to memorize and share with another person. Moreover, this is a logically airtight argument. If the two premises are true, then the conclusion follows necessarily.
And sure, I could have used similar deductive reasoning to disprove quantum mechanics. That's the science of the very small, in a similarly airtight and necessary fashion. But there's a reason why the band's not getting ready to play. Why the Nobel Prize Commission is not getting ready to roll out the red carpet. You see, there's a tinsy problem with this deductive reasoning, Craig. And it goes a little something like this.
All elephants are pink. Nelly is an elephant. Therefore, Nelly is pink. Logical?
Perfectly.
You know what a human would say to that?
What?
Elephants aren't pink.
Humans do not understand logic.
Yep, that's right, Bill. If your premises are wrong, the deductions made from those premises will probably be wrong too. In science circles, it's called GIGO. Garbage in, garbage out. In order to understand why the Kalam cosmological argument is pointless hand-waving about an unknown, you need to understand why this William Lane Craig-style disproof of relativity is wrong. Well, it's simple. It's taking inductive and intuitive and a seemingly valid pair of observations and assuming their universal validity and then linearly extrapolating them to places where they fail. Sure, every object you have ever come across, when pushed forwards, does move forwards faster every single time. As Craig would say, we have good reasons to believe that it's true, and you can find the formulas in any physics textbook, and it certainly seems more probable than its negation. Every object you have ever pushed moved faster, just as every event you've ever witnessed had a cause. But only when you understand the mathematics that accurately describes motion, and not before, will you understand why not everything pushed forwards moves faster. Speed of light's kind of a unique point like that, and I don't think I'm going out on a limb too much to say that the initial state of the universe was probably a similarly unique condition. The lesson is simple. Intuitive linear extrapolations into the very small, that's the quantum, and the very high energy essentially the relativistic, are known to fail. Now let's take a look at the problem that Craig is trying to describe with his simplistic intuition. Oh yeah, that's right, the beginning of the universe. Pretty much the smallest and most high energy state you can think of.
All of the mass and all of the energy contained in all of the 400 billion galaxies we see in our universe in a region smaller than the size of a single atom. The entire observable universe was a millionth of a billionth of a centimeter across at that time. Everything was compressed into an incredibly hot, dense region.
Look, we're not coming at this blind. We have precedent that intuition will serve you poorly in events that extrapolate to such singularities. Saying that
whatever begins to exist has a cause
is the same intuitive and inductive... You tell them, Craig.
People are so unsophisticated in their thinking. I am just appalled, honestly, when I read the stuff that's out there on the internet, how inept and sophomoric people are.
Steady, Dagger. I would have settled with just saying it's the same inept reasoning that would lead the inexperienced to erroneously believe that they have used Craig-style philosophy to disprove relativity, or to convince Davros that Nelly is pink. Look, Craig, there's a simple reason why the theory of relativity and not Craig-style deductive arguments are used to describe motion. Because one is a demonstrably accurate description of reality. In scientific terms, what we would call a theory. It can be robustly used time and time again to make accurate predictions of the unknown. While the predictions made by this pointless philosophical hand-waving can be shown to be wrong. As the old axiom goes, the proof of the pudding is in the predictivity. It's the ultimate standard by which we judge good models from bad ones.
Okay, so special relativity, the faster I go, the slower time is going to go.
Yes, relative to the clock left on the ground.
Okay, and general relativity, the further away I am from a massive object like a planet, the faster time is going to go.
That's right.
So which one of these is going to have the biggest effect on our time dilation experiment?
The bigger effect actually occurs due to the general relativistic effect.
And it said, for example, that time is actually going to run slower for somebody who, say, standing on the surface of the Earth where there's lots of gravity, relative to, say, somebody who's floating around on a spaceship where there's hardly any gravity at all. Now, you may think that this just sounds absolutely bonkers, but, for example, the satellites that control your car sat-nav wouldn't be able to work without taking relativity into account.
I absolutely proved the theory. Not that it needed proving. I am categorically 230 nanoseconds older by taking that flight than I would have been if I'd stayed on the ground.
But let's just say for the sake of argument that we didn't understand relativity, just as we don't understand the beginning of the universe. At which point, the comparison of these two arguments becomes perfectly analogous. Until you can demonstrate some accurate prediction of the unknown, everything that you do will remain pointless hand-waving about an unknown, about a gap of knowledge. And to be frank, until we have a satisfactory description of the beginning of the universe, as we have a satisfactory description of relativity, the origin, if even such a word is appropriate, of the universe will remain to be addressed by its fitting title as an unknown. And yeah, doubtless this is why Craig is here in the first place. The only place left for him to hide his God is in the gaps of human knowledge.
Everything science learns pushes God back. We used to see mystery everywhere and explain it with God, but now everything science explains, God gets smaller.
And the beginning of the universe is merely one of the last places he can still hope to hide his God in. You see, Craig, in years gone past, folks like you would have marveled at the rainbow, saying, it says in the Bible that God made the rainbow because he felt guilt pangs after an act of global genocide. How else can you explain the rainbow? I mean, let's use inescapable philosophical reasoning to prove this. Premise one, the Bible says the rainbow exists. Premise two, rainbows actually exist. Conclusion, therefore the Bible is true. But joking aside, look Craig, it's simple. There's a reason why quantum mechanics, relativity, refraction and so on were mapped out by scientists. And not by intuitive hand-waving of your brand of logically and inescapably airtight philosophical reasoning.
Science works.
So I guess that puts the ball back in Craig's court. Why, given the track record of intuitive reasoning's demonstrable failure in predicting the very small and the very high energy, do you think that such hand-waving at an unknown commodity. That is a gap of knowledge at the beginning of the universe, if beginning is even the right term to use, which is, let's be honest, as small and high energy as you like to get, will allow you to conclude, therefore God, with any more validity than pre-Einstein. It could have been used to validly conclude that faster than light speed travel is possible. Remember, Craig, it's garbage in, garbage out.
That the way in which I know Christianity is true is first and foremost on the basis of the witness of the Holy Spirit in my heart. And that this gives me a self-authenticating means of knowing that Christianity is true wholly apart from the evidence.